Good evening, everybody. We are grateful and glad that you take the opportunity to join us this evening as we have an opportunity to be reminded of what took place over the next 4 days. We're going to be reading a lot of scripture this evening, as well as a couple readings. And then beyond that, there's going to be some songs that are played. We would love for you to sing and join along with those if you can. We want this to be somewhat of a contemplative service, and so we're asking that you would be willing to maybe turn your lights down a little bit lower in the room and what you're watching, and really just reflect on your relationship with Jesus. As we get started, just two announcements I want to bring to your attention. First of all, I know some of you are probably thinking, are we doing communion tonight or not? We're not going to be doing that. We're also not going to do it on Easter. We had a discussion about it and really just decided that when the good Lord brings us all back together, we're going to do communion at that point and celebrate together being able to be the body of believers as brothers and sisters in Christ. And then the second one is I'm still looking for pictures of you or your family that if you can send them either by email to me or by text. I want to put together a little bit of a sort of Easter celebration from our church family. So please get those in to me. And it doesn't have to be, you don't have to have a sign or anything written that says Happy Easter. We would love for you to do that. But if anything, just get your picture in so we can see your wonderful face and be reminded that we are a bigger body. As we go into this evening, again, I just want to start with just a word of prayer. And then we will continue from there. So let me pray. God, our Father, as we come before you this evening, we thank you for this opportunity that we have to be able to just come into your presence. And Lord, we are reminded that there's power within your scriptures. And sometimes it's the simplest things that can touch our hearts the most. And so I just pray that you will allow us on this evening just to take some time to ponder and set aside maybe all that is around us, to put it out of our minds for but a brief moment, and just to be able to focus on the beauty of our relationship with you, the incredible love that you shower down upon us, and all that you have provided for us. God, our Father, again, bring blessing to this evening. We pray that your Holy Spirit would be with us. And we ask this in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Hear these words from the scripture. Now there were some Greeks among those who went up to worship at the festival. They came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, with a request. Sir, they said, we would like to see Jesus. Philip went to tell Andrew. Andrew and Philip in turn told Jesus. Jesus replied, the hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Very truly I tell you, unless a kernel of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it remains only a single seed. But if it dies, it produces many seeds. Anyone who loves their life will lose it, and anyone who hates their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me. Where I am, my servant will also be. My Father will honor the one who serves me. Now my soul is troubled, and what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour. No, it was for this very reason I came to this hour. Father, glorify your name. And then a voice came from heaven. I have glorified it and will glorify it again. The crowd that was there and heard it said it had thundered. Others said an angel had spoken to him. And Jesus said, this voice was for your benefit, not mine. Now is the time for judgment on this world. Now the prince of this world will be driven out. And I, when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all people to myself. He said this to show the kind of death he was going to die. And the crowd spoke up. We have heard from the law that the Messiah will remain forever. So how can you say the Son of Man must be lifted up? Who is this Son of Man? Then Jesus told them, you are going to have the light just a little while longer. Walk while you have the light before darkness overtakes you. Whoever walks in the dark does not know where they are going. believe in the light. Well, you have the light, so that you may become children of light. When he had finished speaking, Jesus left and hid himself from them.
Oh, Jesus, Son of God, so full of grace and truth, the Father's saving word, so wonderful are you. The angels long to see, and prophets search to find, the glory we have seen revealed. You shone upon the earth.
The way of Jesus goes through the cross, but we are not there yet. It is close. We can see its shadow. We can feel the cold, dark night. We know that the enemies of God are conspiring, and they have had enough of him. He threatens their comfort. He threatens their way of life. He threatens their power. And they will come for him. First, though, we will gather. We gather with Jesus and his closest friends. We gather with those that call him teacher, rabbi, and friend. We gather for the Passover meal to remember that God saved the people from slavery. God saved once, God saves forevermore.
It was just before the Passover festival. Jesus knew that the hour had come for him to leave this world and go to the Father. Having loved his own, who were in the world, he loved them to the end. The evening meal was in progress, and the devil had already prompted Judas, the son of Simon Iscariot, to betray Jesus. Jesus knew that the Father had put all things under his power, that he had come from God and was returning to God. So he got up from the meal, took off his outer clothing, and wrapped a towel around his waist. After that, he poured water into a basin and began to wash his disciples' feet, drying them with the towel that was wrapped around him. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" Jesus replied, "You do not realize now what I am doing, but later you will understand." "No," said Peter, "you shall never wash my feet." Jesus answered, "Unless I wash you, you have no part with me." "Then, Lord," Simon Peter replied, "not just my feet, but my hands and my head as well." Jesus answered, "Those who have had a bath need only to wash their feet. Their whole body is clean, and you are clean, though not every one of you." For he knew who was going to betray him, and that was why he said not everyone was clean. When he had finished washing their feet, he put on his clothes and returned to his place. "Do you understand what I have done for you?" he asked them. "You call me teacher and Lord, and rightly so, for that is what I am. Now that I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also should wash one another's feet. I have set you an example that you should do as I have done for you. Very truly I tell you, no servant is greater than his master, nor is a messenger greater than the one who sent him. Now that you know these things, you will be blessed if you do them." When he was gone, Jesus said, "Now the Son of Man is glorified, and God is glorified in him. If God is glorified in him, God will glorify the Son in himself, and will glorify him at once. My children, I will be with you only a little longer. You will look for me, and just as I told the Jews, so I tell you now, where I am going, you cannot come. A new command I give you, love one another as I have loved you, so you must love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you love one another."
Servant, I
Even as they were sharing this sacred meal together, the disciples were not of one heart. Jesus knew that he was asking much from these men, and he knew that they would fail him. Judas had already agreed to betray Jesus to the religious authorities. Was he angry at some slight? Was he disappointed that Jesus would not raise an army against the Romans? Was he upset with the value of the oil that the woman wasted when she anointed Jesus? We will never know Judas's heart, but Jesus knew that he would be betrayed. And what did Jesus do with the man that would betray him? He broke bread with him. All of the disciples were deeply saddened, and they asked,
"For I received from the Lord what I have passed on to you." The Lord Jesus, on the night that he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and he said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And in the same manner, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it, in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." After he said this, Jesus was troubled in spirit and testified, "Very truly, I tell you, one of you is going to betray me." His disciples stared at one another, at a loss to know which of them he meant. One of them, the disciple whom Jesus loved, was reclining next to him. Simon Peter motioned to his disciple and said, "Ask him which one he means." Leaning back against Jesus, he asked him, "Lord, who is it?" Jesus answered, "It is the one to whom I will give this piece of bread when I have dipped it in the dish." Then, dipping the piece of bread, he gave it to Judas, the son of Simon Iscariot. As soon as Judas took the bread, Satan entered into him. So Jesus told him, "What you are about to do, do quickly." But no one at the meal understood why Jesus said this to him. Since Judas had charge of the money, some thought Jesus was telling him to buy what was needed for the festival or to give something to the poor. As soon as Judas had taken the bread, he went out, and it was night. When he was gone, Jesus said, "Now the Son of Man is glorified, and God is glorified in him. If God is glorified in him, God will glorify the Son in himself and will glorify him at once."
We all start on the outside, the outside looking in. This is where grace begins. We were hungry, we were thirsty, with nothing left to give, or the shape that we were in. And just when all hope seemed lost, love opened the door. Door. to the hero and the coward, to the prisoner and the soldier, to the young and to the older, all who hunger, all who thirst, all the last and all the first, all the paupers and the princes, all who failed and then forgive, all who dream and all who suffer, all who love and lost another, all the chained and all the free, all who follow, all who lead, anyone who's been left out, all the lost who have been found, all who've been labeled right or wrong, to everyone who hears this song.
Afterwards, Jesus led his disciples to the Garden of Gethsemane. He asked them to pray for him, for he wanted to be alone. There, Jesus prayed. He asked his friends to keep watch, but they kept falling asleep. He prayed for another way out. He prayed in anguish. He prayed as a man who could feel pain, who would be hurt by betrayal, who would be scarred by the scourge, and would bleed when nails were driven into his arms and legs. He prayed as a man who knew that if he followed God's will, he would be charged, convicted, mocked, humiliated, abandoned, and nailed to a cross. Knowing all of this full well, he prayed, "Not my will, but yours." Then he stood up for all that he had lived for. When he got up from prayer, he came to the disciples and found them sleeping. "Why are you sleeping? Get up and pray that you may not come into the time of trial." Judas said to Jesus, "Rabbi," and kissed him. Then they came and grabbed Jesus and arrested him.
Surely he has borne our grief and carried our sorrows. Yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace. And with his stripes we are healed. To see the King of heaven fall in anguish to his knees, the light and hope of all the world now overwhelmed with grief. What nameless horrors must he see to cry out in the garden, "Oh, take this cup away from me, yet not my will, but yours, yet not my will, but yours." To know each friend will fall away.
Jesus, having prayed this prayer, left with his disciples and crossed over to the brook Kidron at the place where there was a garden. He and his disciples entered it. Judas, his betrayer, knew the place because Jesus and his disciples went there often. So Judas led the way to the garden. The Roman soldiers and the police, sent by the high priests and Pharisees, followed. They arrived there with lanterns and torches and swords. Jesus, knowing by now everything that was coming down on him, he went out and he met them and he said, "Who are you after?" And they answered, "Jesus the Nazarene." And he said, "That's me." The soldiers recoiled, totally taken aback. Judas, his betrayer, stood out like a sore thumb. And Jesus asked again, "Who are you after?" And they answered, "Jesus the Nazarene." "I told you," said Jesus, "that's me, I'm the one. So if it's me you're after, let these others go." This validated the words in his prayer, "I didn't lose one of those you gave." Just then, Simon Peter, who was carrying a sword, pulled it from his sheath and struck the chief priest's servant, cutting off his right ear. Malchus was the servant's name. Jesus ordered Peter, "Put back your sword. Do you think for a minute I'm not going to drink this cup that the Father gave me?" Then the Roman soldiers, under their commander, joined the Jewish police, seized Jesus, and they tied him up. They took him first to Annas, father-in-law of Caiaphas. Caiaphas was the chief priest that year. It was Caiaphas who had advised the Jews that it was to their advantage that one man die for the people. Simon Peter and another disciple followed Jesus. That other disciple was known to the chief priest, and so he went with Jesus to the chief priest's courtyard. Peter had to stay outside. Then the other disciple went out, spoke to the doorkeeper, and got Peter in. The young woman who was the doorkeeper said to Peter, "Aren't you one of this man's disciples?" And he said, "No, I'm not." The servants and the police had made a fire because of the cold and were huddled there warming themselves. Peter stood with them, trying to get warm.
Annas interrogated Jesus regarding his disciples and his teaching. Jesus answered, "I've spoken openly in public. I've taught regularly in meeting places in the temple, where the Jews all come together. Everything has been out in the open. I've said nothing in secret. So why are you treating me like a conspirator? Question those who have been listening to me. They know well what I have said. My teachings have all been above board." When he said this, one of the policemen standing there slapped Jesus across the face, saying, "How dare you speak to the chief priests like that?" Jesus replied, "If I've ever said something wrong, prove it. But if I've spoken the plain truth, why this slapping around? Then Annas sent him, still tied up, to the chief priest, Caiaphas. Meanwhile, Simon Peter was back at the fire, still trying to get warm. The others there said to him, aren't you one of his disciples? He denied it, not me. One of the chief priest's servants, a relative of the man whose ear Peter had cut off, said, didn't I see you in the garden with him? Again, Peter denied it. Just then, a rooster crowed.
They led Jesus then from Caiaphas to the Roman governor's palace, and it was early morning. They themselves didn't enter the palace because they didn't want to be disqualified from eating the Passover. So Pilate came out to them and spoke, what charge do you bring against this man? They said, if he hadn't been doing something evil, do you think we'd be here bothering you? Pilate said, you take him, judge him by your law. The Jews said, we're not allowed to kill anyone. This would confirm Jesus' word, indicating that the way he would die. Pilate went back into the palace and he called for Jesus and he said, are you the king of the Jews? Jesus answered, are you saying this on your own or did others tell you this about me? Pilate said, do I look like a Jew? Your people and your high priest turned you over to me. What did you do? My kingdom, said Jesus, doesn't consist of what you see around you. If it did, my followers would flight so that I wouldn't be handed over to the Jews. But I'm not that kind of king, not the world's kind of king. And then Pilate said, so are you a king or not? Jesus answered, you tell me, because I am a king. I was born and entered the world so that I could witness to the truth. Everyone who cares for truth, who has any feeling for the truth, recognizes my voice. And Pilate said, what is truth? And then he went back out to the Jews and he told them, I find nothing wrong in this man. It's your custom that I pardon one prisoner at Passover. Do you want me to pardon the king of the Jews? They shouted back, not this one, but Barabbas. Barabbas was a Jewish freedom fighter.
So Pilate took Jesus and had him whipped. The soldiers, having braided a crown from thorns, set it on his head, threw a purple robe over him, and approached him with, Hail, King of the Jews! Then they greeted him with slaps in the face. Pilate went back out again and said to them, I present him to you, but I want you to know that I do not find him guilty of any crime. Just then Jesus came out, wearing the thorn crown and purple robe. Pilate announced, here he is, the man. When the high priests and police saw him, they shouted in a frenzy, Crucify! Crucify! Pilate told them, you take him. You crucify him. I find nothing wrong with him. The Jews answered, we have a law, and by that law he must die because he claimed to be the Son of God. When Pilate heard this, he became even more scared. He went back into the palace and said to Jesus, where did you come from? Jesus gave no answer. Pilate said, you won't talk? Don't you know that I have the authority to pardon you and the authority to crucify you? Jesus said, you haven't a shred of authority over me except what has been given you from heaven. That's why the one who betrayed me to you has committed a far greater fault. At this, Pilate tried his best to pardon him, but the Jews shouted him down, if you pardon this man, you're no friend of Caesar's. Anyone setting himself up as a king defies Caesar. When Pilate heard those words, he led Jesus outside. He sat down at the judgment seat in the area designated Stone Court, in Hebrew, Gabbatha. It was the preparation day for Passover. The hour was noon, and Pilate said to the Jews, "Here is your king." They shouted back, "Kill him! Kill him! Crucify him!" Pilate said, "I am to crucify your king?" The high priest answered, "We have no king except Caesar." Pilate caved into their demand. He turned him over to be crucified.
Carrying his own cross, he went out to the place of the skull, which in Aramaic is called Golgotha. And there they crucified him, and with him two others, one on each side, and Jesus in the middle. Pilate had a notice prepared and fastened to the cross, and it read, "Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews." Many of the Jews read this sign, for the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and the sign was written in Aramaic, Latin, and Greek. The chief priest of the Jews protested to Pilate, "Do not write the King of the Jews, but that this man claimed to be the King of the Jews." And Pilate answered, "What I have written, I have written." When the soldiers crucified Jesus, they took his clothes, dividing them into four shares, one for each of them, with the undergarments remaining. This garment was seamless, woven from one piece from top to bottom. "Let's not tear it," they said to one another. "Let's decide by lot who will get it." This happened that the scripture might be fulfilled that said, "They divided my clothes among them and cast lots for my garment." So this is what the soldiers did. Near the cross of Jesus stood his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother there and the disciple whom he loved standing nearby, he said to her, "Woman, here is your son." To the disciple, "Here is your mother." From that time on, this disciple took her into his home. Later, knowing that everything had now been finished and so that scripture would be fulfilled, Jesus said, "I am thirsty." A jar of wine vinegar was there, so they soaked a sponge in it. They put the sponge on a stalk of the hyssop plant, and they lifted it to Jesus' lips. And when he had received the drink, Jesus said, "It is finished." And with that, he bowed his head and he gave up his spirit.
Praise the Lord.
As evening approached, there came a rich man from Arimathea named Joseph, who had himself become a disciple of Jesus. Going to Pilate, he asked for Jesus' body, and Pilate ordered that it be given to him. Joseph took the body, wrapped it in a clean linen cloth, and placed it in his own new tomb that he had cut out of the rock. He rolled a big stone in front of the entrance to the tomb and went away. Mary Magdalene and the other Mary were sitting there opposite the tomb. The next day, the one after Preparation Day, the chief priests and the Pharisees went to Pilate. "Sir," they said, "we remember that while he was still alive, that deceiver said, 'After 3 days, I will rise again.' So give the order for the tomb to be made secure until the third day. Otherwise, his disciples may come and steal the body and tell the people that he has been raised from the dead. This last deception will be worse than the first." "Take a guard," Pilate answered. "Go, make the tomb as secure as you know how." So they went and made the tomb secure by putting a seal on the stone and posting the guard.
What a wondrous love is this, O my soul, O my soul. What a wondrous love is this, O my soul. What a wondrous love is this that caused the Lord of bliss to bear the dreadful curse for my soul.
Father, we thank you for this evening, and we thank you for the opportunity that you have given us to be reminded of all that you endured for our sake. And Lord God, our Father, as we are reminded of that, may we look forward to what is to come. Tonight, We remember your time with your disciples. We remember being arrested in the garden. We are reminded of the trial that took place, the beating and the torture and the whipping and the crown of thorns and all that you endured. We have this image in our mind of you hanging on that cross and doing it because of our sin. And Lord, we leave tonight with you in the grave, behind a big stone in that tomb. Lord, may we contemplate truly the sacrifice that it was, the incredible love that you shower down upon each one of us. We are so unworthy, Lord, and yet you allowed your Son to go through what he did because of your love for us. Lord, may you just be with us as we have this opportunity in thought. We ask all this in your name, Lord Jesus. Amen.
Were you there when they crucified my Lord? Were you there when they crucified my Lord? Oh, sometimes it causes me to tremble, tremble.